Hello. Welcome to the Methuen Memorial Music Hall, home of the great organ. I'm Matthew Bellocchio, president of the Music Hall Board of Trustees. This year, we're celebrating the 75th anniversary of the 1946 acquisition and incorporation of the Music Hall as a nonprofit cultural center, and our 75th summer recital series. This is the 14th program in our 15-week series. We'd like to thank our sponsors, whose generous support has made this year's recital series possible. This program is sponsored in memory of Edward Searles Rowland, a longtime recital sponsor. And we invite you, our viewers, to visit our website, mmmh.org, and click on the donate link to help support the Music Hall. And don't forget to like and share this video and hit the red subscribe button. Thank you. Tonight's performer, Rosalind Mohnsen, is director of music and organist at Immaculate Conception Church of Malden, Medford, Massachusetts. A native of Nebraska, she received the Bachelor of Music degree in piano from the University of Nebraska and the Master of Music degree and Performer Certificate in organ from Indiana University. Her organ studies were with Myron Roberts, Conrad Morgan, Robert Rayfield, and Jean Langlais. Rosalind has performed at many prestigious venues in the United States and for the AGO chapters in Richmond, Lincoln, and Pasadena. She has been a recitalist at 23 national conventions of the Organ Historical Society and the 2014 AGO National Convention in Boston. Rosalind has also played in Latvia and Sweden. Her first music hall appearance was in 1978. She has since become a popular performer here. This is her 13th music hall appearance. Tonight, we are also introducing some new talent. We're pleased to welcome Justin Livingston and Matthew Ricetti, the two young percussionists who will perform with Rosalind in the Pierre Cochereau Boléro. Justin and Matthew were our 2020 Music Hall Scholarship recipients. By coincidence, both are studying at Berklee College of Music in Boston. Rosalind proposed using them for this rarely heard organ and percussion piece, and we heartily agreed. We are proud to present these two young musicians as they begin their careers. We hope you enjoy this program. Now, please welcome Rosalind Mohnsen.
It is wonderful to be able to welcome a live audience this evening, as well as, of course, the live stream audience. It's always wonderful to be in this special space playing this fine organ, sounding better than it ever has. This program opens and closes with two composers whose anniversaries are observed this year, Marcel Dupré, 50th, and Saint-Saëns, 100th. Now we have a change in style, going to 19th century Germany and listen to some Schumann and Mendelssohn. After Schumann had his mental breakdown, Clara, his wife and composer, proposed that they work on some musical contrapuntal exercises for a challenge, for diversion. And some of the results of this work were the Opus 56, six canonic studies, and the Opus 58, four sketches. So I'm playing one of the six canons tonight. Those were originally for pedal piano, but now they're usually played on the organ. The Mendelssohn work was for a long time thought lost. The manuscript was in a library and then got moved to another library during the Second World War and was rediscovered in the 1980s. It's a one-movement work, but the Allegro flows right into the Chorale and the Chorale flows right into the Fugue. So, Schumann and Mendelssohn.
Thank you.
Quite a few years ago, when I attended a recital at Notre Dame Cathedral in Paris, I heard the Boléro played by Pierre Cochereau. He had improvised it 1 year earlier, and his son later transcribed it. So when I heard that the two scholarship winners last summer were both percussionists, I said, maybe this is the time to do the piece. It does get very loud in the middle. It builds up to a large crescendo and then comes back down again. Would you please welcome Justin and Matthew?
Good evening. My name is Heinrich Christensen, and over the past 20 years, I've had the great good fortune to be invited to play here several times, but perhaps more importantly, over the last, 10 years, I've been a regular concert goer, a merry gaggle of colleagues of mine from the greater Boston area, and I have made a point of coming up to Methuen on a weekly basis. Whenever we're in town in the summer, we'll make an evening of it and come up here. And every time I walk in, I'm just struck by the grandeur of this space, and any of you who have been here in person can attest to that. It's just a magnificent space, and to me, it's a vestige of that gilded era that you so often hear about. As somebody said to me last week in reference to a different grand building, it's a building that predates the income tax. And for all of us who do anything creative, I think we all have our dark days where we think, oh, why am I spending all these hours practicing this Vierne symphony? Who cares? And so to me, it's just a wonderful affirmation to come into this space and think that, well, Mr. Searles cared. He cared to the point that he bought this organ that was languishing in storage, and he built this hall to house it. And ever since, wonderful people have continued his work. So there came a time after income tax and probably after the Great Depression and all those sad things that it wasn't so practical for one person to own a hall like this anymore. And so that's today, why today we have the great board of trustees that runs the Methuen Memorial Music Hall for all of our benefit and puts on this wonderful series of concerts that has been going for 75 years now, which is such an accomplishment in and of itself. And where today's billionaires seem to, you know, want to travel into space rather than build organ halls, I think we all owe a great debt of gratitude to Mr. Searles and to Mr. Skinner, who owned his hall for a while, and to the Board of Trustees for keeping this going all of this time. And while running the Methuen Memorial Music Hall is probably not quite as expensive as space travel, it still requires some money. So I urge you to go right now to www.mmmh.org and click that donate button so this can keep on going for another 75 years and beyond. I think that's about all I should tell you for tonight. I think we should get back to what we're all here for. And welcome back, Rosalind Mohnsen.
Designed with three pieces, all of which relate to symphony, but in different ways. First, we have a movement of an organ symphony by Louis Vierne, the blind organist of Notre Dame Cathedral in Paris. And this does not try to sound like an orchestral symphony, but rather conveys the drama and the symphonic style of the 19th century. Then the next piece, Meditation, quotes a theme from an orchestral symphony. Sainte Clotilde in Paris is the church that was served by César Franck as organist for many years. So you can imagine yourself in that space, and a melody comes into your head, and it's a quote from the Franck D minor symphony. Philip James was an organist and composer in New York City. Lastly, a transcription of a movement of an orchestral symphony with organ for solo organ. A few interesting details about this finale. The composer himself, Saint-Saëns, said that two pieces in his repertoire originated with improvisation at the organ, and this is one of them. So interestingly, it started out as organ, then became an orchestral piece, and now it's been transcribed for organ. Also, the main theme at the beginning bears a strong resemblance to the Ave Maria of Arkadelt, a Renaissance motet. So we know Saint-Saëns was acquainted with that piece, and perhaps that's what he was thinking of in his main theme. So Vierne, Philip James, Saint-Saëns, and thank you very much for coming this evening.